What's up, guys? Got another Vic vlog for you today. We are going to find out how to turn that into that. But before we get into that, my wall's looking a little bit bare over there, so I got something to fix that. There we go. Got a few more flags up. I need to put some shelves up there eventually and some cabinets, but for now, flags make it look good. So like I said, this video is mainly going to be about how I did the dash and how I got that screen molded into the dash like that. I will go over how I mounted the brain and a few other little things about just going over the parts that I painted and whatnot, but mainly it's going to be about how to build the dash because there's been a ton of people that have asked me how I did it and the processes that I went through to get there. So we'll do that. Afterwards, we'll take it out and find a place where we can crank it up and listen to how it sounds. And I'll go over some of the features that the head unit has that I have it set up for. So if you found the video helpful, hit the like button, subscribe if you want to see some more stuff like this. I'm not totally done with the bike yet. There's still quite a bit that I want to do. So there will be some more content coming out like this. I plan on making my own bag lids with cutouts for speakers eventually. And a few other little things like that involving the stereo. So if you want to see some of that, subscribe and let's get into it. There's a ton of pictures to go through.
All right, guys, so I showed you what the final dash looked like. Now we're going to go over how it got to that point. And I've got about 100 pictures to go over. I took a ton of pictures, never took any video. I wasn't making YouTube videos at this time. But I've got a ton of pictures to go over. We're going to kind of break it up into three sections. The first section is going to be just the dash itself, how I got the screen attached to it, and essentially getting it to the point where it's primed, ready for paint on the bike and working. The second part is going to be kind of everything else I did with the stereo, the aftermarket speakers I put in, the amplifier, how I attach the brain unit to the bike, and all of that is going on underneath the front fairing. And then the third section is going to be how I painted all the parts and how the bike was torn apart, and just a few pictures of that. Not going to go into a whole lot of detail with anything really besides the dash. That's kind of the main thing that people have asked about and wanted to know how I did. So let's go ahead and dive into it. So this first picture here is obviously the finished product. This next picture here just shows you that the face plate is detachable. There's a space underneath where you can press the button to detach it from the unit itself. So whenever it rains or whenever I'm parking at a place where I don't want to leave the stereo on, I can pop it off, throw it in a saddlebag, lock it up, don't have to worry about it getting stolen or getting wet. So we'll go over a few of the materials real quick first before I dive into everything. Obviously, you're going to need fiberglass mat, and you're going to need some polyester resin for the fiberglass and a hardener agent it comes with. You're also going to need brushes, a fiberglass roller to make sure you get the bubbles out. Later on, you're going to need some body putty spreaders, some lightweight body filler, and some stuff called Dynaglass, which is a fiberglass filler. It's a pretty much a body filler that has fiberglass strands in it to make it a little bit stronger. You're also going to need some various sandpapers. I did use a Dremel in part of this process. Just some tools like that, but we'll kind of go over those once we get there. Another item that is very helpful is a mold release agent for whenever you get done fiberglassing. That way the fiberglass mold will come off the thing that you're molding around fairly easy. All right, so the unit that I went with was a Pioneer Nex 4100 head unit. I went with this one because the Nex 4200, which is the year newer head unit, and the 4100, were almost identical, very, very similar features. There really wasn't a whole lot of difference between the two, and this one was about $80 to $100 cheaper at the time whenever I bought it. The reason I went with this particular unit is the faceplate is detachable, which is going to make it so much easier to be able to extend that faceplate away from the brain unit itself. And here's that cable I'm talking about. So this is with the screen and the back plate behind the screen pulled away from the brain unit. There's about a 5 to 6 inch cable there that just snaps in to the brain circuit board. That cable goes from the brain to the back of the mounting plate for the screen and just clips in there with that little black bar that's running across the top of the cable. That'll allow us to get a longer cable to be able to extend that screen away from the faceplate. Here's what the end of that cable looks like. I'll put the description of what it is down below, as well as everything else I'm using. I'm going to be putting links to Amazon so you can purchase all this stuff and be able to do this on your own. But this is a 60-pin, 0.5-millimeter thick flex cable. This particular one on the unit is only about 5 to 6 inches long. I was able to source one out on eBay that was 500 millimeters long, which is roughly 18 inches, which is more than enough for what I needed to do. Unfortunately, there's just not a great place to get these. Amazon doesn't carry them from what I've seen as far as the length that I needed. eBay was the only place, but it was very reasonable. It was only about, I want to say, $10 or so, and it came with two cables. So for whatever reason, if one of them gets messed up, you have a spare. But like I said, I was able to find it on eBay and get it shipped for about 10 to 12 bucks. Here's what that cable looks like and what the screen looks like extended away from the brain. As you can see, it's much longer than the stock cable that it comes with, and it powers up the screen just fine. I've had zero issues with it. It's just a longer cable connecting the screen. So now we're going to get into how I actually made the mold and got the mold into the dash. So I took the screen and the metal plate that it attaches to off the brain, and I built a shell around the outside of it to be able to build the mold and it have a space around the screen, so it's not it's not rubbing or it's not super tight in there. I did that using Kydex, which is just kind of a soft plastic. The thickness was 0.08 inches for that particular plastic. If I had to do it again, I would probably go with something a little thicker, maybe about an eighth of an inch or 0.125 inches. It just took a lot of sanding once I got the finished product done, throughout the process to be able to get the screen to fit in there correctly again after pulling it out of the mold and after applying body putty and whatnot. That'll just give you a little bit extra room to put in your body filler and sand it smooth, and you're not going to have clearance issues. After you get the barrier built, use some blue painter's tape, tape it down to a solid surface, and tape around it a little bit because we're going to be building the mold on top of the actual unit itself with the screen face down. So you're going to be putting the fiberglass on the metal back plate. I went ahead and pre-cut all of my fiberglass mat so I could just lay it along the sides or lay it along the back. If I had to do this part over, I would still make those cutouts and, cut out for the back and for the sides, but for around the edges, I would probably pull the mat apart into the strands and have a big pile of strands and not take the mat and fold it over those edges. It's just going to give you a nice cleaner edge. The mat's going to stick down a little bit easier because it's not in a thick sheet. It's just going to be single strands. Before I started laying the fiberglass down, I used a little bit of that mold release agent that I talked about earlier. That'll just help whenever we get done with the mold for letting it come off. So this is a picture of me laying down the mat. So overall, I did three layers of fiberglass to create the mold. Here it is taken off of the faceplate there. But this gives us a good starting point. This is our mold for the screen to be able to fit inside, and we'll start doing some cleanup now. I'm not going to show all of the layers that I did with the Dynaglass or body filler or anything, but here's a few pictures of the first layer of Dynaglass that I put in. Mainly for the backside, I only use Dynaglass because that's going to help with the structural stability of it with that fiberglass strands and the body putty. So both on the back and on the inside and backside, of the mold, I went ahead and put a couple layers of that Dyna-Glass filler. Next, I went ahead and cut out a bottom section of the mold so the screen could fit in and you can still access the quick release button for the screen so you can detach it. Next picture here shows a square cutout of the back side of the mold, and that is to allow the cable to attach to the mounting plate. So at this point, I had to attach the metal mounting plate to the mold itself. And to get the screen to be able to fit on the mounting plate still, I did have to bend where those screws go in a little bit. Even though they're super flat, and in most cases, you know, they're going to be out of the way of anything, you know, that it needs to be up against, that screen would not properly attach to the mounting plate unless those were recessed a little bit, because that screen sits right up flat up against that plate. Here you can see the back side of the mold. As you can see, the two screws there on either side are holding that metal plate in, and that square in the center is where our wire is going to connect. And this isn't pretty, but like I said, no one's going to see it. It's strong. That's all that matters. So here are just a few pictures of the teardown process. So here you can see where the stock radio normally is. There's a hole cut out so the mold can fit inside there and attach to the dash. After I liked how it looked, I went ahead and took the screen out and I set it in with some CA glue. After the CA glue cured, I put everything back on the bike, dash in, and I test fit it to the bike to make sure there wasn't going to be any issues with it hitting the tank. As you can see here, I did full turn left and right, and it missed the tank by roughly 3/4 of an inch to a full inch on either side. All right, so with everything back off the bike, here's a shot from the back side of that mold. I just put some of that Dyna-Glass around the edges so it would have a good strong hold up against the plastic dash. I also did it around all of the edges on the front side of the dash. Obviously not as thick and terrible looking, but here is right underneath the shift indicator and gauges. And then the next few pictures are along the side and bottom of the mold. So the next several pictures are going to be of the bodywork process that I did. Pretty much all the fiberglass, Dyna-Glass is done at this point. Now it's just lightweight body filler and kind of getting the contours and the curves that I wanted to kind of match the dash from the factory. It took quite a bit of body filler, it took a ton of sanding, and you know, this was a time-consuming process, but to get the lines that I wanted, that's what I had to do. Again, before adding any body filler, I did go over the dash with 80 grit sandpaper where it was going to be touching the dash so it had a good strong rough bond to hold on to the dash. So as we're going through these picks here, I think it took roughly about 3 good heavy coats of the lightweight body filler before I was really getting the buildup and the curves that I was wanting to match the factory dash. Anytime that I did a layer, I would go over it with 80 grit sandpaper just to knock down the high parts and then go over it again to get a little bit more buildup and to match the factory curves. Once I got it down pretty close to what I wanted, and it was just more filling in the pits and gaps and things like that, I moved to 150 sandpaper and 220 sandpaper if I was really trying to smooth out the edges. And here's a short little video just kind of going over what I'd done so far. This is probably about 80% done. I hadn't sanded the top part of it quite yet. And you know, there's still quite a few little pits and holes to fill in, and I had to go over the front of the mold along that front edge as well. There are a few pits in there still. I did go back and fill those later, and you know, I actually primed and sanded that area, I think about 2 to 3 times total. But here are some pictures out in the sunlight. You can see it's looking pretty smooth at that point, and this is you know, about 95% done. There's some finishing work still left to be done on it. So at this point, I had actually gone over the entire dash with 220 to kind of knock down the roughness that the stock plastic had on it, and also kind of rough it up to accept the primer. But I did go over the entire dash with primer. This was in preparation for painting it later on down the road because I knew I was going to be painting it. And just to kind of give it a uniform color because I was going to be riding around with it like this for a while just to test it all out to make sure it was functional before I went through the trouble of painting everything. That cable is attached to the back of the mounting plate there. It's going to go underneath the gauges or behind the gauges up into the front fairing and attached to the brain unit up there. And here it is on the bike. Like I said, it's pretty much finished at this point as far as all the body work on the dash, but this is the look of it. Still need to paint it, still need to put everything together, but it was on, it fit, worked great, looked good, so I was pretty happy with it. Here's also a few pics from a couple different angles and with the head unit on. So that kind of wraps up how I made the dash itself. I'm going to go into a few other items here, like I said. I'm going to go over the equipment that I put in for the stereo upgrade, as well as how I mounted the brain for the head unit, which it took a little bit of thinking to be able to fit everything in there, but I think it turned out pretty well, and it'll give you guys an idea of how to mount things in there yourself if you want. So first, some of the equipment that I put in there. For the front speakers, I went with Hertz Audio HSK-165s. That is the kicker front fairing speaker that comes from the factory, so you can see it's a pretty massive improvement over that. Here's a picture of the adapter plates for those 6.5-inch speakers from the 5.25 that was stock. Those are in there wrong currently. The shortest side needs to go up top. I just don't have a picture of it mounted in there correctly. And here are the speakers inside the dash there once it's all connected. As far as the tweeters go, I ended up using the mounting cups that came with the Hertz Audio setup there. And there was an angled side on those mounting cups that I was able to drill a few holes in and mount to the inside of the fairing there that houses the speakers. And it sat out of the way of the 6.5-inch woofer, and it was a solid mounting point. So that's what I ended up doing for those. Now for mounting the brain, I was mounting both the brain for the head unit and the JL amplifier that I was going to be putting in, which is the JL MX 500-4. For the head unit, I ended up taking some 18 gauge steel and bending a few brackets and mounting with self-tapping screws to the aluminum chassis that the gauges are connected to. Now to mount the JL audio amplifier in there as well, instead of putting it beside it or in another area in the front fairing, the best way I found to do it was to actually mount it to the head unit itself, or to the brain of the head unit. So on the left side over there, you can see there's two screws that are mounted into the top of the brain of the head unit. And then off to the right side, I made another L bracket and put some screws through that for the amplifier, and then mounted into a couple mount holes on the side of the brain. Here you can also see the other L bracket that I made for the head unit. Once I got all that figured out, here is everything back inside of the dash. None of the wires are really connected yet, but this is just everything fit up and ready for connecting all the wires. So here's everything wired up and somewhat tucked out of the way. I did end up putting an ASWC1 module inside there as well to retain the factory hand controls with the stereo. So I am able to turn up and down the volume, skip tracks, change between modes, and also mute. This picture here just shows a little shield that I ended up making out of some Kydex to help with any sort of rainwater or whenever I wash the bike, if it were to fall from the top of the dash there down inside. This is made from 0.063 thick Kydex. I pretty much just cut out a large square section, trimmed it where I needed to, took a heat gun and molded it down around everything, and gave it a little lip to where it'll just run off if it does get wet. It's not pretty, but it's sitting under the dash, no one ever sees it, and it serves its purpose. And just kind of finishing up with a few things with the stereo install. I did run the USB extender from the head unit underneath the tank, underneath the seat, and down where the stock connector was for the iPod. So I'm able to plug a standard USB cable into and charge anything or run my phone off of it, which is what I do 90% of the time for navigation and music and that sort of thing. Here's the trunk area of the bike. I ended up replacing the rear speakers with some Hertz HCX-130s. These are the 5 1/4 inch coaxials, and they're quite a bit bigger than the stock speakers. I had to cut out a pretty large section of that trunk there for them to fit. I still need to make some sort of covers or completely carpet the trunk and cover it up whenever I do that as well. But that is the size of hole that you're going to need if you're going to be fitting some bigger speakers back there. So here is the bike. About 4 months after I'd got everything going, sounded great, worked awesome, didn't have any issues. So I took most of the bike apart to get the small pieces off that I wanted to paint and the dash apart all again so I could paint the dash up. But here's most of the parts I had laid out here to paint. I did paint the blinkers, the saddlebag hinges there, the front bezel around the headlight, speaker grills, obviously the dash I painted. I did paint the windshield because I'm 6'5 and I look over the windshield, so I wanted it to match the rest of the bike. And then a few other little trim pieces there, the bezels and the locks there for the saddlebags. And just going through everything pretty quick, went ahead and did an adhesion promoter on everything that was either chrome or plastic chrome. That's just going to help the primer stick and the paint stick down the road. Once it was primed, let it dry, went over everything with 600 grit sandpaper to get everything really smooth, and then went on with the painting process. For all these parts, I just use a standard black base coat. My bike is black and silver, and I did all these parts in black. So standard black base coat, and got the matte clear from Color Right, who is the supplier for the factory paints for Victory Motorcycles. Here's just a couple close-up shots of the parts after they were painted and cleared. They did get a little more matte after this. They were still in part of the drying process. And here's the dash after everything was painted. The inside of that mold there looks a little rough, but that metal plate's going to be going over it. You're never going to see it, so it doesn't matter. But it turned out super smooth. That matte clear laid down just perfectly. You can't sand and buff this stuff, so it was really important to get it, you know, smooth the first time and not get any orange peel on it or anything like that. And this stuff did a great job, so I was super pleased with the results. While I had everything apart, I also did tint my taillights, the taillight there for the back fender and on the trunk, as well as all of my blinkers. To do this, I used a two-part urethane clear coat and mixed about 10% black paint in with that clear coat to give it a little tint. I put about 2 to 3 light coats over all of the lights after putting an adhesion promoter on there, and then went over one final coat with the matte clear to take away the sheen. And last, here's a couple final pictures of what the bike looks like put together as far as the dash. That cigarette lighter over there, I did end up running the microphone for the head unit into that cigarette lighter. I pulled the back plate off, drilled a hole, and was able to run the wire through the microphone through that and glued the microphone in there. What I mainly use that for is for my Google Play app and the Android Auto feature that this Pioneer unit has. You can hit a button and tell it what to play or tell the navigation that you want to go to. If you don't use that cigarette lighter, go ahead and pull that out, throw the microphone in there so you have that ability. That's the build, guys. I hope you liked it. I hope the video wasn't too long. I know it was kind of a tedious process getting through all the pictures. It wasn't quite as exciting without video, but hopefully this gives you an idea and can help some of you guys out who are wanting to tackle this on your own. You've seen it all put together, so let's go hear how it sounds.
All right, guys, it's really windy today, but I think I found a decent spot where I can turn this up, and we won't have a lot of the wind messing with the sound. We'll run this at 30 and see how it sounds. Guys, I just got back. Sorry, it was a little windy out there. I don't know if you heard it real well, but I was just going to show you a few of the things that that it's set up to do that I use it for. First off, you got navigation. Everything is running off of my phone, which is in the cord in the saddlebag there that you saw earlier. So you've got Android Auto running, which got your Android Auto icon there. This is great just for not stopping at a stoplight, pulling out your phone, or pulling over to see wherever you're going if you're not familiar with where you're going to. Obviously, you can make phone calls. I've got the microphone in that little port there, like I said. Don't really use it for that a whole lot. I do tell it what to play or where to go. If I'm on the road, I can just pop that off. If I'm at a stoplight, I can yell into it, and it picks up what I'm saying. And then I use this mainly for Google Play for all of my music, and I can obviously play a song, turn up and down with my hand controls here. I can mute it, or attention, with that bottom button, and then I can shift my tracks up and down as well. As well as I program this top button, the mode button up there, to change my source. So I can do auxiliary in or Bluetooth or whatnot. It, whenever the phone's cooked up, it automatically verts back to Android Auto, but there's that function as well. I almost forgot the most important part. Okay, so this unit, the reason I chose it is because the screen can remove. So just turned it on here. There's a little slider underneath that you push right there, and that's why I have that cutout. The screen comes off completely, throw it in your saddlebag. You know, if you need to wash the bike, whatever, hook it back on the top, push in from the bottom, snaps in, back up and running. Hope you guys liked the video. I went through a lot of stuff. Like I said, if you found it helpful, give it a like, subscribe if you want to see some more of this stuff, and thanks for checking it out.